primeiro programa sobre a história da Eurocopa mostra como o torneio surgiu e por que também é chamado de Copa de Lené. Mas o melhor goleiro do mundo leva os soviéticos ao título do primeiro torneio. A Fúria Espanhola vence pela primeira vez uma competição internacional. A Itália renasce depois do fracasso e a Alemanha nasce para o sucesso na Europa.
By 1918, the nations of Europe were finally at peace with each other. The British Tommy had fought valiantly to defend that bad Johnny foreigner. The future promised tranquility for returning heroes. Association football had been molded and given a rule book by the British, this island race whose empire stretched the length and breadth of the civilized world. The years between the two great wars proved a boom time for football across the United Kingdom. Unfortunately, an island mentality remained deeply entrenched within the football consciousness of the British. Why play international competitions abroad when the best football is found on British shores? What do the Continentals know about the game anyway? However, one Continental who did understand the game was Hugo Meisel, an international referee and secretary to the Austrian FA. Hugo Meisel, who was born into a well-heeled family of Austrian bankers, had kicked over the traces to become the visionary of modern European international competitions. It was this friendly, avuncular man who was the first football administrator to recognize the true potential of national teams competing for international trophies. The Mitropa Cup and the Nations Cup, both conceived and organized by Meisel, were the forerunners of the present-day European Champions Cup and the European Championship. Italy, Switzerland, Austria, Hungary, Czechoslovakia and Yugoslavia, all were to prosper from the skill and foresight of Hugo Meisel during those early, unstable European years following the First World War. In 1919, the Treaty of Versailles meant that the armies of sacrifice would never again scar the face of humanity, or so they promised. More than 3 million men had charged from their trenches and were now fertilizing the fields of Europe. Politicians and generals had sanctioned this pitiful carnage over 4 long, flesh-ripping years. They said it could never happen again. The Allies had swiftly dismantled the old Austro-Hungarian Empire to create the modern nation of Austria. Sundays in the Vienna of Hugo Meisel appeared pleasant enough. Yet underneath this veneer of normality, the other profile of Austrian society was one of displacement and fractious political agitation. In England, meanwhile, the high spot of the football calendar remained the FA Cup final played at Wembley Stadium. Yet more often than not, this historic occasion, with its community singing, its eager anticipation and its royal patronage, often appeared rather more solemn than joyous. Only one man amongst the elite of English football could be compared to Hugo Meisel. Herbert Chapman of Arsenal became both confidant and football soulmate to the Austrian maestro, Chapman understood fully the need for the British establishment to listen, to learn, and to embrace the methods of their continental neighbors. Yet unfortunately, the closest that so many English supporters came to their counterparts across the Channel was the giant Zeppelin, which cast a broad shadow over the 1930 FA Cup final. While Benito Mussolini, El Duce, strode the parades and the assemblies of Italy throughout the 30s, in Germany, Herr Hitler was planning to devour those countries within marching distance. It was against this jackboot landscape that another football visionary was shaping a national team which would become the envy of the world. Vittorio Pozzo, the Italian team manager, was a contemporary and friend to both Hugo Miso and Herbert Chapman. Despite Mussolini's many failings as a dictator in the eyes of his German counterpart, Il Duce was a shrewd manipulator who enjoyed being seen sharing the people's game. Pozzo was the first European team manager to successfully embrace the politics of the moment to the benefit of both his team and his own reputation. And when Pozzo's impressive Italian sides won their political masters, the 1934 and 1938 World Cup finals, it is perhaps interesting to speculate just how jealous of Mussolini the lunatic in Berlin might have been. The answer was probably that der Führer didn't have a whole lot of interest in football at the time. He was, after all, rather busy annexing Austria. With Europe dominated by the canker of fascism, competitive international football was assigned to the bottom drawer of day-to-day existence. Continental Europe had been sliced into a jigsaw puzzle of displaced nationals in search of a safe haven. Until such times that the goose-stepping, book-burning arrogance of Nazism could be defeated, the lights of European sport were extinguished for the next 6 years. Football fixtures between competing countries started to flourish once again. Now the hordes of wanderers and outsiders could enjoy a fresh nationhood, whatever their race or religion. Scandinavians, Slavs, Latins, and this new European ethnic mix suddenly seemed to be reflected upon the terracing of the early post-war football grounds. If any one man could claim credit for the progress of the European Championship, it was undoubtedly Henri Delaunay of France, secretary of the French Football Association and one of the founding fathers of UEFA. Delaunay built conclusively upon the groundwork so carefully laid by Hugo Miso, and this